convivência das nações que compõem a União Europeia segue princípios fundamentais que eventualmente podem entrar em conflito com a Constituição de cada país integrante. Para falar desse tema, Cidadania convidou dois juristas alemães, o professor Dr. Martin Nettesheim, da Universidade de Tübingen, e o professor Dr. Markus Kötzur, da Universidade de Hamburgo. Sejam bem-vindos aqui ao nosso programa.
Thank you.
It's a pleasure.
Seien Sie
willkommen. It's good to be here.
Great pleasure. Thank you.
Ok. Como foi a experiência de reconstruir o arcabouço jurisdicional, a Constituição alemã, agora que já decorrem 25 anos da queda do muro?
It was on the one hand, I would say, an easy step. On the other hand, a very, very complicated and actually lengthy process. It was easy in the sense that Germany decided to disintegrate the East German legal system completely after 1990. There was nothing, almost nothing, there were certain minor elements, but basically nothing was taken over. The Western German legal system was implanted into East Germany. And in the early years, a lot of bureaucrats, public officials, and judges went from Western states to the newly erected Eastern German states to help with the construction of the new legal system. However, of course, implementing such a system into a legal cultural environment that was so different took a while, and we have now overcome that. From a legal point of view, I would say we are now one unified country.
Para o ensino do direito dentro das universidades alemãs, o que mudou após a queda do muro?
Well, I think, first of all, that students from the eastern part of the country and the western part of the country started studying together. And in the beginning, in the eastern part, it was a very exciting endeavor to re-establish law schools, to have the new teaching program, and of course also to reflect on the reunification process, which was in the early years immediate history and which is now becoming a bit more history. But I think that kind of studying and living together was an important thing, even though the schedule and the curriculum not completely changed. It was still the same legal program we had before, and of course European law and European integration became even more important after the time of the reunification, and maybe one topic we might add which was interesting for law school teaching: in the reunification process there was a big debate whether Germany should have a new constitution or whether Germany should keep the old constitution, the Grundgesetz. And for political and practical and very different reasons, the country decided to keep the old, well-established Grundgesetz, the old constitution, and not to introduce a new one. And that was a law school topic we discussed in, you know, constitutional law classes quite a bit.
Nós começamos falando sobre os conflitos entre a Constituição da União Europeia e a Constituição de cada país. Quais foram, ao longo da existência da União Europeia, quais conflitos o senhor colocaria como os mais importantes, os de maior destaque?
Obviously, the growing together of Europe, of states that want to maintain their ability to act on themselves and by themselves and to remain sovereign states into a quasi-federation on the European level creates a lot of tensions. Obviously, although there's a common understanding that things should move ahead and that we want to have more integration, there, of course, the interests are different. Look at the United Kingdom and their perhaps particular way that they are going. So it is quite common, actually it started already in the 1950s, that we see integrative movements and then steps back, and it seems as if we are currently in a phase in which European integration is struggling again. On the one hand, we are struggling in the area of financial integration and the operation of the monetary union. It has become clear that the architecture built in the 1990s in the Maastricht Treaty is not functioning well. We have seen almost catastrophic developments there. We have overcome that by the help of the European Central Bank, but the new architecture has not yet been established, neither in the area of financial markets nor in the area of the monetary union. The other area that we are going to talk about at our conference then also is human rights. Traditionally, the member states were protecting the human rights through their own constitutional courts. In the 1950s already, an additional level or layer, the Court of Human Rights in Strasbourg, was added. But now the European Union is also developing its own European Human Rights Charter with a still not yet settled reach upon the member states. And there are now movements as to how to define human rights in Europe.
A Constituição brasileira atual completou no ano passado 25 anos e ela praticamente terminou um período de exceção da democracia. Não havia uma democracia plena no país. A Constituição americana, ela é basicamente uma declaração de princípios. Por contraste, a Constituição francesa, por exemplo, era muito detalhista. E essa parece ter inspirado a Constituição brasileira. Como se coloca nesse quadro a Constituição da União Europeia?
Well, that's a very tricky question because it's also very lengthy. You know, a very famous German scholar, Konrad Hesse, said that the art of the Constitution is a Constitution has to be very short, very clear, very precise, the American tradition. And of course, this is not true for the European treaties. First of all, the Constitutional Treaty failed, you know, after no's in France and in the Netherlands. And so we have a constitutional framework composed of three primary law treaties, the Treaty establishing the European Union, the Treaty on the Functioning of the European Union, and the Human Rights Charter. I'd say the Human Rights Charter, even though it's also very detailed, has a clear constitutional quality, being a traditional human rights instrument, and the treaty establishing the European Union is also clear enough, so to say, even though there are some technical provisions included. The Treaty on the Functioning is extremely long, extremely detailed, and the primary law is not only constitutional law in the traditional sense, but it's also about technicality, is about administrative instruments, so it's a big mixture, and therefore it's very important for the citizens to accept that as their constitutional document. This is the real problem of the European Union, and to make a long story short, in France, before the plebiscite regarding the constitutional treaty, every citizen got a copy of the treaty, of the draft treaty. And people said it was the worst mistake the French government could have made, because reading now these 400-something complex articles, of course, everybody would say, well, we don't get a word, we don't understand that. This is the missing constitutional quality, constitutional semantic of the European primary law. That's the problem. I totally agree. If you had it brief and short, it might be much better, but it will be a very long way to improve that and to kind of, in the future, draft maybe a real European constitution.
Mm-hmm. But the shorter the document, if I may add, the more you leave to the political process.
That's also the problem,
Then you're again at the constitutional conflicts, and that member states do not, at least in certain areas, do not trust themselves.
Absolutely, I totally agree.
They want these texts to put the certain things out of the political discourse.
Yeah.
And we see a situation in which actually distrust is increasing, and the problems are getting currently certainly not better than worse than they were 15 years ago, I would say.
A vida não é hoje o que era 10, 20 anos atrás. Veio a internet, as redes sociais, as comunicações mudaram, tudo mudou. Existem novos conflitos éticos, conflitos no campo da saúde, conflitos temáticos e, sobretudo, aqueles que reclamam soluções. Por exemplo, do ponto de vista de proteção dos consumidores. O que acontece na Constituição alemã e na Constituição da Europa, por exemplo, com relação à internet?
In general, I would say that the consumer protection law in Europe, and it is now partly national and partly European Union law, is really strong. You could with the joking undertone, you can probably say it's a socialist system compared to what you see in the United States, for example. It has actually been the grip of this law and the density of protection has actually been tightened and augmented over the last couple of years. Especially the European Union is indeed getting into these new technologies, trying to protect people who buy things online, and more particularly buying things online over the borders into another or from a seller in another member state. So the idea is to create a common electronic market where everybody can sell and buy with the protection of the law. However, that is, you can understand, it's a difficult and long process. Not because of fraudsters and all that, but also just the linking of the technical and the legal system, then the enforcement system, the court system that ultimately has to then enforce all that. It takes time, but I think we're on a good way.
Maybe one should add that also privacy rights are, of course, a big problem when it comes to social networks. And there are quite some cases that might arise in the future and already concern European courts. The European Court of Justice had to decide on the Google case in that context. And, of course, privacy data, the use of data within social networks are a big, big issue. And I think there is a lot of work still to be done because the legal framework is not all that clear, because national laws are not sufficient anymore. That internet has, you know, very obviously a transnational dimension, and therefore you need to find at the end of the day transnational regulations, which is the most important topic, and which is a topic that creates lots of conflicts, I would say, given the different legal traditions. But there is ongoing debates, and I think there is also ongoing process of lawmaking and also of judge-made law, and the European Court of Justice will, I think, face in the future some further cases, especially regarding privacy rights and the protection thereof.
Muito obrigado por terem vindo aqui ao nosso programa. Cidadania conversou com os juristas Martin Nettesheim e Marcus Kotzur sobre possíveis conflitos entre legislação comunitária e legislação nacional. Mande suas críticas e sugestões para nós. Ligue para 0800-61-2211 ou acesse www.senado.leg.br/tv. Nesse endereço você pode ver de novo ou baixar uma cópia de qualquer programa da TV Senado, inclusive este. Obrigado pela atenção e até o próximo Cidadania.